Together again, again. Gee, it's good
It's
to be
good to be
together
together
again,
again,
again.
again.
I
I
just
can't
can't
imagine that
imagine
you've
that
ever
you've
been
ever been
gone.
gone. It's not
It's not
starting
starting
over.
over. It's just going on together
Interesting.
again, again.
You could have told me that you were
Never
getting
give
sad.
back.
Not to mention it's quite dramatic. I'm just feeling my Bono glasses, and you've got this whole different bit. Now I'm
Oh.
cold.
We're not even in sync to begin with.
Screw that. I'm like, wear this shirt.
Oh well. Hey, I was caught up in the moment.
Oh, how sweet.
I am Bono for this video. No reason. I just think I look good as Bono.
So
Very
this mo
nice.
so this
The
podcast is
Watchman.
sponsored by the Starving Children.
Winged
Like
out, St.
that.
John. It's getting sleepy.
It's not sleepy. It's something else.
Oh. Okay.
Oh, I love this. Oh my
Keep
god.
this in! Keep this in! This shit is gold!
This is what makes Cinema Royale. This is
Now,
what.
this is the cold opening. It's what makes Cinema Royale so royale.
There can be only one.
I have come here to chew bubble gum and kick ass. All out of bubble.
Go ahead. Make my day. Cinema Royale.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Royale, where we celebrate movies and discuss them. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape, and this is it, everybody. This is our 2-year anniversary of starting the podcast.
Yay.
Yay.
Yeah.
Why am
Damn
I
it.
still here?
I give you my pretentious clap. Yes, I care very deeply.
I have a career,
Yes.
what the hell am I doing here?
So, yes, 2 years ago, I uploaded the first episode of Cinema Royale, and it became history. Oh.
Those were the days.
Those were the days, I tell you. 2013 was a great year for podcasting, I tell ya. So let me introduce you to my esteemed colleagues of film here, with going from left to right according to my side, the point of view you're looking at, not to everybody else's view. Anyways, first up, we'll go with Matt Brunet, also known as Animat.
Hey, everybody! Seriously, why am I still here? I should be doing my own things.
You had a 10-year contract.
Yes.
Crap, that thing.
Yep.
Where is it again? Hold on, let me just check. I should learn how
What a
to read.
convenient stack of papers you had there, Matt.
You actually, it's
They're
not
just
10 years. You
perfect for
signed
that
for
moment.
life.
Oh, look,
Life.
here's my contract. See?
Yeah,
Hey, there's a check attached to it.
yeah. Hey,
You
we're
get paid
fine.
for this?
So I
You actually get
appreciate.
paid for this?
Yeah,
No.
see?
Read that again.
Oh,
Void.
Oh,
I want to get
void.
paid void money.
Next up is the return of the comeback kid, Morgan Ledger.
Yeah.
I am Groot.
Oh, you're
Like he
moved.
said.
Several months too late there, buddy.
Though I am gonna say, eons ago, remember I made that little rant about how I was disappointed in the setup of the DVD cases?
Oh,
The fact that they're
yeah.
just stacking them on there?
Yeah.
Oh boy! Let's see what we have here. 80s comedy! Isn't this interesting? Oh, I'm just gonna open up here and see if I can watch one of these guys. You fools!
Oh my god.
Apparently, we're not learning a good lesson here.
No. Yeah, I guess.
Hold on, can you open the can you take off the little paper on the side just to be clear? What the
Look at
fridge is
it!
wrong with this?
They're
So is it
all.
it's all one disc?
They're
No,
all
they're
stacked.
five
They're stacked
stacked on each
on
other.
top.
Look at this. Just, my God. Good.
They're
Whatever
stacked.
happened to the flippy things that you would put
Yeah.
in the cases?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, apparently
Oh,
they
flippy
save.
things.
Apparently they save that for much lesser stuff like Seuss. Oh, no, that's not it. God damn it. Okay. Why do we
Yeah,
get
those
this?
things.
Why
How
do we
much
get
work?
this?
What is that, an extra $5? How hard is that?
This came out in 2013. That was 2014.
Okay, you're weirding me out with your really quiet anger. Like, come on, raise the volume a tad.
Let's just say there's some...
You found me out your way, so if you're worried about that...
You know that, you know, like, in our houses, we're not the only people here, you know?
Neither am I, but, you know.
You do realize that.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Right. We know a thing about... We have this thing called respect.
Yes.
No, I don't.
And next to Morgan is James Sullivan, also known as Homitude.
Okay. Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by Hollywood Studios. Please hold. Hollywood Studios, please hold.
Hollywood
Studios... Hollywood Studios.
You guys will understand that later.
Shit, it's context for later in the episode.
That's what I said.
Last, but not least.
What he said.
Nope. To your right. Yeah, there you go. There you go. Perfect.
Wait.
Last but not least is our...
I was pointing left anyway. Oh, I fucked up my own joke.
Stop laughing. Okay. Last but not least is our fresh new co-host of the podcast that came actually about like 2-3 months ago is Jada.
Yeah, I'm not so fresh anymore.
You are fresh to us, no matter what.
You are fresh to me in every way.
Anyways,
you may not be fresh, but that dress certainly is.
Thank you, it's a shirt. But... Good try.
Since this is the podcast's 2-year anniversary, we figure we go a little personal with our lives and our taste in film and talk about our number one favorite films. Yes, one. There's five of us. There's five of us, and last time we did this, it was a chaotic mess. We talked about 10 films, and that was episode 40. We talked about robot films. Ooh, boy, that was a mess. So we're going to condense it down a bit to half and talk about one film each. Should be a nice, relaxed episode. Not long and congested like the previous one.
Don't listen to him. This podcast will go in ruins.
So, let's start it off alphabetical order, starting with Jada.
Am I alphabetical order? Are you sure?
Yeah, J-A-J-A-M.
We got three M's and we got two J's.
Who does alphabetical order with the first names? It's usually a last name thing. Oh, well, whatever. Doesn't matter to me.
Talk about your favorite film, Jada.
Well, I don't know about my favorite film. See, here's the thing. Having a favorite film, when you're a big fan of films, is unbelievably difficult. You know, because you have favorite films in certain genres, but then you'll feel certain ways about those genres depending on your mood, depending on what movies you're familiar with, depending on what movies you've seen recently, depending on so many things. And different favorite movies that you have say different things about different stuff that you like in films. So I just want that to be clear, Mr. That's right, number one. Number one ever.
Okay.
It's not as easy as all that. Maybe it is for some fuckers, but it's not as easy as all that for everybody.
Alright, totally understandable. That's
Thank
fine.
You. The movie that I eventually ended up choosing was one that I do consider among my favorites. And more than that, I like it. Not just because it's good, but because I can consider it a very substantial what to do right when making the kind of film that it is, you know? Because this movie is an example... I can see the confusion on Morgan's face, so I'm going to take this in a different direction.
What? No. I'm listening.
Oh, okay. You're just always...
This is how I am when I'm listening.
Oh, okay.
If I'm confused, I'll just do a little face like this.
I'll keep an eye out for that. I'm never comfortable in this chair, so.
Okay.
Robin Williams. He's been brought up already. He is mm-hmm. a man of... He was, unfortunately, a man of endless hilarity and much, much talent. However, I think I can... At least I can feel comfortable saying, with all the respect in the world, that while he was alive, not all of the movie choices he made were good.
Yeah.
He made a few bad movie choices, particularly in the 90s. And the movies that he made that were bad kind of all had very similar things in common. Like, Robin Williams was quirky and different, and this individual who had this dream of reaching out to people, but the man, the big serious corporations and old people, they don't approve of his shenanigans because they're all unorthodox. You know, but he just wants to teach people things from the soul and how to learn to laugh at yourselves and to explore your creativity and be individuals and the big bad organizations, they won't let them do that. But and they're all... Every bad movie that he made did this. At least most of them. Not Ferngully. But that's not the point. The point is, I think we can blame this trend of movies that were trying but failing to be this inspirational Robin Williams masterpiece on the original inspirational Robin Williams masterpiece that actually did it right. That movie is called The Dead Poets Society.
Mmm.
There we go.
Carpe diem.
That's the reason. It was because of Dead... That was his... When he
Dead
first...
Dead Bowels?
Dead Poets Society. That was the movie. It may not be his biggest success, as opposed to, say, Good Will Hunting, but it is the movie that shaped the Robin Williams vehicles that came afterwards. They were all trying to be Dead Poets Society. And when I first watched Dead Poets Society, I thought I was going to hate it, because it seemed very much to be the Patch Adams and the friggin' Flubber and the Bicentennial Man and all those movies that were trying to be that. And it amazed me how much the movies exceeded my expectations and ended up being touching to me in a way that I think all those other movies were trying to be. So the reason I chose to talk about is because I wanted to discuss what Dead Poets Society did that the other movies didn't, and why it is as memorable and never duplicated, like the genie himself, as it is.
Never duplicated,
duplicated.
Genie of the lamp. Yes, right away. Thank you very much. Thank you. Over to the shoe, gentlemen.
Get it out of your system.
Listen.
Dead Poets Society, for those of you not in the know, is about an old boarding school for, like, the higher upper class rich white kids who are, like, uber privileged and uber educated and going on to go to these expensive universities and be lawyers and stuff like that, living very serious, very organized, very controlled by their red foreman parents' lives. One of the kids has a red foreman parent, we'll get to that. They go to English class, and their English teacher is played by Robin Williams, and Robin Williams has a very different way of teaching them. He teaches them in ways that the other teachers don't approve of because they're, you know, unorthodox. It's that kind of thing again, right? Instead of going by the textbooks, he tells them to go outside and experience life and think about things in a creative aspect and stuff, you know? And the students, they all embrace his teachings wholeheartedly because, you know, they're still young and they're kids and they don't have anybody else who's talking to them like this. And so they form together a version of something that Robin Williams said that he did when he was a kid, which was called the Dead Poets Society, which is when a bunch of students come together at night, meet up in the woods, and share poetry with each other and make up their own little poems and talk about, you know, how poetry affects them and shit like that, you know? And the movie's basically about the students who are in this society, who are trying to be individuals and learning from Robin Williams and trying to fight their parents and the teachers and all these people who are, like, pushing them down, you know? Trying to learn something. And I know it sounds like a really cliched Robin Williams vehicle when you put it like that, but see, the thing that separates Dead Poets Society from the other movies is that it's... I'm going to take these off and be serious with you. It's so much more real than any of those other movies. First of all, Robin Williams himself, he's a lot more toned down. Like, he's not totally over the top. He doesn't wear a clown nose. He as someone who grew up in, like, regular old public schools in Canada, so they weren't all shitty, he acted very much like a fun kind of teacher could foreseeably act, you know? He related to the teachers. He gave them important stuff to do, but he also gave it to them in ways that they could access, and he wasn't afraid to be humorous, but he also had a very genuine point to make, and he was very serious and dedicated to his work, and he did act like an adult. And he acted like an adult who had some smart things to say. And the fact that they're in, like, this upper crust, rich white kids, they're all white kids in this school. There is not a single non-white kid in this school ever. And it's, I don't think it's because of the movie. I think it's because that's how those prep schools were.
The whitest, you know, kids, you know, right here.
Yeah. The kids acted like kids. And they weren't hesitant towards Robin Williams' teachings. In fact, the one kid... I forget his name, but he was the kid who wanted to be in a play, but his father wouldn't let him be in a play.
Midsummer Night's Dream he wanted to be in.
Yeah. He ended up being Puck, and that didn't go so well. But he was so enthralled by Robin Williams' teachings that he put together the Dead Poets Society largely
Neil.
By himself. Neil?
Neil, that's his name, Neil.
Good memory you got there, unless you looked it up like a chicken. You know, even the shy Tim Robbins character, who was shown to be, like, the most hesitant, he wasn't hesitant because he didn't like the individuality of it, he was just hesitant because he was shy and insecure, and there was a lot in his character that I could kind of relate to, being somewhat of a shy person myself, you know, that the kids, they acted like kids, and they were kids that you could root for, and kids that you could understand, because the movie is largely about them.
Tim Robbins was in the movie?
Is it Tim Robbins? No, it's not Tim Robbins. I'm sorry. It's
Ethan Hawke.
That's it.
Yeah, I was going to say, he seemed a little bit old at that point to be playing a prep school student.
Ethan Hawke is like a much boyish Tim Robbins. If you can picture a more boyish Tim Robbins, that's Ethan Hawke.
I think basically. I'm a boyish Tim Robbins. No.
Mike? It's for you. It's God. He says we have more. He says we have to have more people on this pod, more girls on this podcast.
Morgan, making me all blushy.
Oh.
I'll think about it. I'll do a casting call.
Dead Poets Society. As someone who has an interest in English and who likes. Thinking creatively and who wants to do that more than I want to do, like, you know, stuffy math and science and shit, because that stuff's boring and takes effort. I kid. I relate to a lot of the things that are in Dead Poets Society, and the fact that it doesn't really end on a happy, everything wrapped up in a pretty little bow note, I don't necessarily want to go into too much detail about it, because there might be, like, you know, a few people, like 5 people, who haven't seen this movie. Maybe. Somewhere. And I want to be sensitive to them. But... It deals with the big tragic event. Like, there's a big thing that happens to the main kid. And his father, who's Red Foreman, doesn't learn anything from it. Like, you think that he's going to have a big epiphany and change his ways, but he doesn't. If anything, he makes the situation even worse. He learns nothing. And that's tragically largely what happens. Like, there was a very recent news story about a girl who had something similar happen to her, and her parents learned nothing. Because they were awful parents. But, like, and things don't go too well for Robin Williams. He ends up not really making as big a difference as you would think, but the students still learn something, you know? Even if they're going through their life and the man is still in charge and they still have their ways, which have not really altered in the slightest. Not even that the man is all that evil, they just, you know, they have old-fashioned principles, and those old-fashioned principles, whether they're aware of it or not, affect a lot of students in a really bad way, but not these students. because Robin Williams and his sharing of poetry and creativity and learning to think for yourselves and enter your own mind and realize what's really important in your life, he changed these kids' lives, and he showed them that there was more than what the older people and what society suspected of them, what expected of them, that they could be who they wanted to be, you know, and that they could appreciate what Robin Williams was telling them. God, it's so hard to talk about this movie without going into the explicit details, but I don't want to because it's such a unique experience, and other that means something more than just, you know, be yourself and be inspirational. If they got deeper than the mere shallow basics of what this movie was about, then Robin Williams would have a much better filmography. And I think it's really tragic that most of Hollywood look at this movie and just didn't get it. They didn't get it. You know what I'm saying?
I think I'll add a little something onto there. Originally, the ending of the movie was to have Professor Keating's die of leukemia, but it was cut because they felt it would be better to focus the movie on the boys. And when we really do think about it, that movie is about the kids in general and going through this big change of the whole film. They're going into college, they have these really fresh minds, and they're always told in school to limit themselves and have all these rules and restrictions to who and how they can creatively act themselves. And here you have Robin Williams playing this professor that says, yeah, you go by the book, but there's no limits to whether you can or cannot go by the book. The world is open to anyone, and the fact that he sells that message, especially the scene where he tells them to rip up the book in general that they're supposed to be studying, clearly shows what his character is. Be loose, be free, be what you really want your intentional to be. That, to me, is the centerpiece of the whole film. He's telling these kids, hey, you can write, but at the very least, don't study what other people have done. Be your own image. Be your own self. And that's something I always look back to whenever I'm doing my work. I remember seeing this movie in high school. High school. And it just made me think exactly just how interesting it is to be that kind of person. Just be artistically expressive. But there's always dangers to it.
And that is important, you know, that the kids are more focused on than Robin Williams. Because I think Robin Williams works better as a side character than a main character. Like, the smaller the doses of Robin Williams in movies, the better, and the more he shines through, you know? And plus, he works better as someone to be inspired by than someone to relate to in these kind of formulas, these kind of narratives, you know? I'm orange again. Oh, well.
It's okay. You're still gorgeous.
You still look good in orange.
Yeah.
Oh, she's been... Oh.
Just whenever you're orange, just consider that a tan.
Yeah, that's it.
You mean I'm going to stay this color?
I haven't seen this movie in a long time. It's probably been about 18 years since I've seen it. I only saw it one time when I was in middle school. My expectations, I guess you could say, of Robin Williams of that time was, okay, he's going to be funny, right? And maybe that's why I didn't latch onto it like some people did. I respect what they were trying to do with the film, and I don't have anything against it. It's just I guess you could say it's been a long time since I've seen it, but I do remember the key points of it, like particularly this stuff you're talking about with the ending and how, because that
Carpe Diem, if you're sees the day.
Yeah. If you're watching all that stuff at a young age, it's sort of impactful, I think. Especially On the behalf of the one character who, you know, he wanted to be an actor, his parents wanted him to do something else, I can sort of relate to that. I think we all come to a point in our lives when we get to a situation where we're thinking, okay, Thankfully, my parents were always supportive of me wanting to be a filmmaker, but one of the relationships that I can bond with that character is that we all have this point where we have our dreams, and we come yay close to it, and we're having to wonder whether or not we should go with the dream or face a reality that we don't want to. And I appreciate William's character for fueling the dream, because without the dreamers, we wouldn't have dreams. Mm. As far as his character goes, I do remember some things. There are points back in his career where later on in his career where they sort of hearken back to Dead Poets Society. With Dead Poets Society, I know what he was trying to do. In that character, what he was going for, the Oscar, and that was one of his.
Maybe one of his priorities.
Well, I read his. I was such a nut of his that I actually read his autobiography in high school, and that was, well, not. I keep saying autobiography. It's not an autobiography. It's a biography. One of the things that he wanted to do just to make sure to be able to and tell his own parents that he had made the best of himself was, you know, to be an Oscar-winning actor.
Well, if that was one of his objectives when doing the role, then fine. But for what it's worth, I don't think it showed that much in his performance. Like, you can see performances. Harrison Ford in 42. That was an Oscar bait performance. He wanted an Oscar with that. And you could tell. I don't think it was like that with Robin Williams in Dead Poets Society. Who here has seen
42? Oscar bation.
Anyone here seen 42?
I know about the number 42.
About the black football player? Baseball player, sorry. Jack Robinson.
I don't know baseball.
Oh, that movie.
Yeah. You watch Harrison Ford in that movie. That's some Oscar-bation right there.
Okay. 1990. Nominated Best Actor in a Leading Role, Dead Poets Society. Nominated. I guess it was close enough.
Yeah.
Have to wait till Good Will Hunting.
Yeah.
I was like, didn't he win? Oh, no, wait, that's Good Will Hunting.
God, they tried to remake Dead Poets Society with other movies so many times. Patch Adams. What was that movie where... Oh, Jack did that a little bit. Yeah.
My favorite reference to Dead Poets Society and later Robin Williams' work was probably in Mrs. Doubtfire when he's at the restaurant and his teeth fall out in the glass, and he says, "Carpe dentum, seize the teeth."
Seize the teeth.
Yeah. So I guess we're good to go with Dead Poets Society. Okay, well, actually, I can give a little bit of my take. Sam,
isn't James
I guess,
next?
Sorry.
No,
hold on.
Let me finish. I have things to say.
Well, sorry. Honestly, same with you guys. It's been a while since I've seen Dead Poets Society. The last time I saw it was in high school. I could definitely understand how it really did set the standards for those go-and dream movies, because like this definitely is one where like it pretty much sets like every tone right, where like the heart, like you get this harsh reality of like school and stuff like that, where it's kind of like It's pretty much the go-to place where to get where to have like a major downer for dreams and stuff like that, and instead, like, be filled with stress and like all these different emotions that don't feel good, and like all that stuff. And then like we got Robin Williams coming in, and like shedding in a new light and giving hope to these kids. So it definitely is. Like, I don't recall much of the performances and stuff like that, because the last time, like, when I saw it in high school, it was in French. But,
Ethan Hawke was pretty great in it. Like, honestly, yeah. Ethan Hawke is kind of usually an actor who blends into the background, but I thought he really stood out in this.
Yeah.
Like, it definitely, like, I could definitely see how it did get a major impact. But, like, it's rather, like, I should probably watch this again just to, like, completely refresh my memory, but yeah, like, so far I'll add that to my list of like things I'll to watch to fully understand.
Everybody should watch it again. I should probably watch it again. It's a movie you can recommend to anybody, if you ask me.
Alright, then I'll put that on my list then, because I have never seen it.
Well, that explains your Mr. Silence attitude.
I just said I had nothing to say, so I was just like, oh, shit, I have not seen it, so I don't have a reference point for it.
Oh, so you've never seen it.
Mm-hmm. You should see it, Mike. Yeah. I think you'd like it.
I will put that on my list to watch. I would definitely do that. There's something I noticed for this episode. There is a theme going on with this episode, especially when it comes to these films, because, of course, these guys give me their films ahead of time, and
like 5 minutes ahead of time.
You're about to steal my line again, aren't you?
I first noticed it when they told me. I was like, there's a theme of, except for one. One person does not have a thing in common, but four of us have films that are from the 80s.
Ah.
Three.
Are you sure Dead Poet Society? I thought Dead Poet Society was 89. Early 90s.
89.
So, like,
I count 90s.
It says 89.
It says it's mid 89, so it counts.
It's 89.
Like, barely the 80s.
It's 1989, though. I will say it was a box office success on a budget of 15.
It was a movie that started a trend.
Oh, 16. Sorry, 16.
You know?
Exactly,
it was,
yeah.
It was a 90s
yeah, it did.
Starter movie.
Yeah, that's what it was. That's
and, like,
was.
The Mermaid and.
Exactly,
I don't know.
Exactly.
Really?
But 89 I do count as the 80s pretty much, but so let's go to another 80s film that James Sullivan has, and it's quite a film. Oh boy. Take it away, James.
Okay. My film is probably the most obscure of the bunch. The Wizard of Speed and Time. Now, Jada, tell me if you've ever heard of this movie.
That's probably a no.
Well,
yes.
I haven't, so I'm not going to tell you.
Okay. So, here's the story. Here's the spiel behind this film. It is the Wizard of Speed and Time is the. Is the piece de resistance of director, filmmaker Mike Jetlove, a man who spent a long time in Hollywood working as an animator for different outlets, making short films. He worked for the Disney Company for many years as an animator. Stop motion is mainly his thing, but he also does some hand-drawn effects and whatnot. And this film started out as a short film that he made in 1980, and later on as he managed to pick up speed more with his career, he made this film, The Wizard of Speed and Time, in 1988, which is a movie about making the movie. And
an op-ed vehicle right here.
Hmm?
I was gonna, it reminds me of that episode of Community where Abed made a movie about Jesus, like it was a movie within a movie within a movie.
Yeah, it's that sort of thing. The reason Mike plays himself in the movie, and the whole plot of the film is he's been hired by a group of television producers, high up in big league television producers, to produce a short film for a video of a visual effects spectacular that they're doing for television, and they want him to act as a character called the Wizard. So he creates this character called the Wizard of Speed and Time, a fantasy character who knows magic with sparkly fingers and whatnot, and he can run fast like Sonic the Hedgehog. So it is a passion project for him, but what he doesn't know is that the two producers that he's working for, one of them believes in him, the other one does not, and they're both betting with each other that on whether or not he can make something worth putting on television. And the amazing thing is, as he's going along, as he's making this movie, it's all stop motion effects that he's using. It's all hand drawn effects, and it all looks terrific. The music, the visuals, it's all very professional on a skin flint budget. And the hilarity is that he goes through so much making this one short film, and the one producer that doesn't want him to succeed in this is doing everything that he can to make sure that his life is miserable. He's denying him availability to shoot on sound stages. He's denying him props. He's denying when he's actually coming up with something that might be good. He hires two goons to pose as police officers and try to go and get him arrested.
What?
Yes. And
It's like Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back, only without the drugs.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, basically.
Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back was like 80% drugs, so not sure what else you're left with.
Yeah. What is amazing about this film is as I watch it again every couple of years, is that there is so much to this movie, and I'm picking up on stuff, you know. This is the movie that later made me want to be a filmmaker. You know, they show you in the film so much about how to do what it is that they're doing, particularly stop motion. And I remember when I was a kid watching this, we picked it up at the warehouse back when that was a thing, over at the town center in town here, and we brought it home. And we watched it, and the next weekend we were kind of like, you know what, instead of going out and renting another movie, how about let's make a movie? And we tried to follow the techniques shown in the film about how to make stop motion. And we created something that I don't have on tape anymore. It was a video of me making my Raggedy Andy doll come to life in my room and use magic to clean my room.
Sounds
it was pretty terrible.
A very terrifying Sorcerer's Apprentice tale.
Yeah, just think of it as like some kind of weird Mary Poppins clone.
Mm-hmm. A terrifying Mary Poppins clone. Raggedy Ann is terrifying.
It can't be as bad as the Papermation short.
Raggedy Ann is scary as shit.
No.
So far, the only stop motion things I did was just this hand. And, like a bunch of random things. Bananas, Pikachus, and DVDs.
Well, we're talking about something here that's shot and edited not even edit it, just trying to get everything as it is in the camcorder. Mm-hmm. And there's no way to do one frame at a time there. So you have to roll the camera for a second and stop. Don't move the camera, move an object, roll. And it was a tedious process, and it looked corny as all hell. But
I wanted to stop motion project for school. It was like this little drawing thing where there was these two drawings, and they were having an adventure because they found a pencil, and they were drawing shit on the paper for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a 5-minute thing. It took like 2 months. Good lord,
yeah.
Stop motion is tedious as fuck.
See, but that sort of started things for me, you know. I later on went into to do acting, and then later on I started to do stuff behind the camera in high school, after high school. My life was changed by this movie. I think I was geared towards, I was imprinted on maybe at a very young age to say, okay, you have been put on this earth to go out and make films. And if you watch this movie, Mike makes the case that movies are his life. You know, this is what he knows, and this is all that he's passionate about. And you can really see that it's a movie that celebrates making movies. And that's what I love about it. I showed it to these two guys, Matt and Mike, just the other night, and Matt, you were saying, you were asking why this doesn't have a bigger fan base and whatnot. Like, mm-hmm. this is some obscure shit right here. The only copy that's going around that you can get your hands on now, if you you can either buy it on VHS, because there's no DVD, there's no Blu-ray, no digital copies. It's that much of an obscure film.
It sounds vaguely.
Go on.
I was just gonna say it sounds vaguely artsy, if you ask me. I'm not sure if it comes across as artsy in the way it's filmed.
Oh, no, it's not artsy. It is not an art film. It's oh my gosh. It's beyond that.
There's no seriousness here.
No, no, no.
Our films don't have to be serious to be artsy.
It doesn't come off as, like, a artsy film.
Yeah.
Technically speaking, Francis Ford Coppola considered The Godfather to be an art film, but we wouldn't think of it as an art film now, would we?
Well, no, because it was commercially successful.
Well, I mean, it doesn't take itself as seriously as an art film. It doesn't really use like metaphors and like hidden meanings and stuff like that. Like you don't dig in as much to find like the message.
I suppose the definition of art films is kind of blurry as it is.
There's a difference between art film and a narrative film, in my opinion. Art film, I think a good example is Akira Kurosawa. There's a movie I saw a few months ago called Dreams, and that's an art film of its own accord, just because of how visually amazing it is. And you don't really care so much about the narrative. You're just sitting in awe as you see like these fairy tale-esque kind of creations coming to life. Like there's this one segment involving a peach tree being represented by these living dolls moving around in this celebratory kind of way. A narrative film is pretty much what is the standard of today, something along the lines of blockbusters or adaptations in general. But there's always that fine line of blurring the two together, where you can just have something so beautifully artistic, and yet at the same time you're following the plot along and saying to yourself, okay, what amazing world are we going to go to next? And I have a really good example for that one later. But in the case of The Wizard of Speed and Time, it's more of an independent self-autobiography. I saw this one a while back. I wish I had the chance to revisit it. Though I do have a lot of good fond memories about it, it's just nice seeing these old-school special effects being put to good use. I wish it got, like, a really bigger reception, because I did not know what to expect going into it. I thought, okay, it's just going to be this fairy tale-esque kind of thing. I didn't think it was going to be about this guy going out there to make a movie. on his own personal accord, and it shows the hardships, the disappointments, and I think that's what really makes it work so well. He wants to make this amazing film, and at the end, without giving too much away, he learns about the hardships of the success and failure of making something like that, and that's really hard to come across in a movie today. I mean, you could argue The Muppets is the closest thing to do that, but they're the Muppets. They can do anything. This is actually straightforward saying, whatever good thing comes your way, there's always going to be a negative. And I think that works really, really well. I really feel bad for Mike. I hope I pronounced his name right.
Jitlov.
Jitlov, thank you. I feel bad for him because I really, really like to see him in the industry more. The last thing I heard he did was like a parody short that was very Star Wars-esque. The only thing he was known for was doing was these special effects for Michael Jackson music video. Actually, wait a minute. Now I gotta get some research here.
I think you're mistaking him for Will Vinton.
Yeah. Will Vinton was the one who went to see Michael Jackson because of Moonwalker.
Okay, I take that back. It's the wrong ghost. It was a special effects technician for the Patrick Swayze ghost.
Yes.
My mistake. It's that ghost. I wish he would get out more in films because he's obviously a nice guy. I mean, he has the rights to the movie. He's allowing it to be bootleg and circulated. I just wish there was something bigger on this because it's like people love this kind of stuff because it's so handmade. It's so humble. That's why my series is not in widescreen or has all these big digital effects. When they need big digital effects, I'll allow it. But when I want something to be simple and humble, like a stop-motion dog, for example, I'll do that sort of thing because that's the person I like. I like doing something simplistic and easy, even though it's difficult to do something simplistic and easy. And I think that's what this film really is. It's not Michael Bay or anything. It's this simple film this guy is making. That's why I appreciate it so much.
Yeah, as proof that that something different is always noticed every time I watch this. As we were watching this last night, I think Matt and I both noticed something. For one, I noticed there's one scene where he's where in order to film a point of view shot of the wizard running, they want to give the audience the illusion of speed, so they mount the camera on a motorcycle and they're racing along this national park that everybody shoots in.
Yeah.
And in Hollywood, and as it switches over to the camera footage showing you the point of view shot, they do the whole viewfinder effect, you know, where to show the audience this is what the camera is seeing, and on the side there's a blinking bit of text that says WizViz. I thought that was a cute thing, and Matt, you noticed somebody in there that I never knew.
Yes, apparently. Yes, like I was just watching, and then suddenly there's this one cameo that I noticed that it just blew me away, and that is one of Walt's nine old men, Ward Kimball. Now this is the guy who did the animation for Jiminy Cricket. For Lucifer in Cinderella.
Cinderella.
He also did Bacchus in Fantasia. Like, and he's like, if you know your Disney, Ward Kimball is possibly the easiest animator to ever recognize because he has these huge round glasses, and he still wears them in this movie. And I thought it was like something out of nowhere and like really cool. So yeah, it's not every day that you get to see a cameo from a Disney animator. The only other one that I can ever think of was either in The Iron Giant or The Incredibles when they added in Ollie Johnson and Frank Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
What was that?
What?
I was just wondering when that was, when they added that cameo in.
Well, okay. I don't really remember much in The Iron Giant, but The Incredibles, that was the end. Like, you just see two guys, and it was like, they don't do that anymore. Yeah, no school like the old school.
I remember that.
Yeah.
That's, I did think that was kind of a weird thing. Like, does that stick out? Is that significant in some way? So that's kind of cool that that was a writer cameo there.
Well, the animators. They were Brad Bird's mentors.
Yeah, the scene that that Ward Kimball makes an appearance in, in order to make this movie, there's one shot where they have to film Mike running on a wall sideways, and to make it look like that he's running on a wall, he's actually jumping up and slamming his feet against the wall, and they're just getting one frame of film at a time. So the guy behind the camera is like, got it. And on the other side of the wall, they don't realize that it's an IRS building. And inside the building, Ward Kimball is playing a tax collector and talking to somebody who needs their taxes. And they start hearing bang, bang, bang. And he's on the phone. He's like, I don't know what it is. It's coming from the east wall. Maybe it's a poltergeist again.
Yeah, it was just, that scene alone was just like, it was ridiculous. It's so cheesy, like, I'm thinking, it's a brick wall, how does that translate to, like, bang, bang on the other side of the building? I'm like, it's a brick fucking wall. But, that's what the film is, it's cheesy, and I like cheesiness when it comes to films. I mean, it's a nice Hollywood slice of life, like, you see how they make movies, and it's kind of, I like actually watching those kind of films. Is just like, that's how they do it. It was a unique experience actually watching the film with James and Matt.
And I gotta say, with this movie, holy crap, the best way to describe it is that this was pretty much a movie if it was directed by Pee Wee Herman, if he was on a freaking sugar high. Because holy crap, they do so many things. Like, the movie does so many things in this 90-minute, in this, like, 90-minute film. And it's like, the entire tone is just madness. Yeah. It's like, it's so fast, it's ridiculously fast-paced. Like, the humor is really off the wall. And, like, what else can I say? It's like, it's just, it's like, everything is just so crazy. And like, it's just so fun. It's just, everything is just so fun just watching it. Like, you're on this crazy ride, and you don't know, like, you never know what's going to come up next, and you never know what's going to happen. And I think it's time that I'm going to say something that's going to be pretty controversial, but I think I honestly do mean it. This is the kind of...
Hold it.
Morgan, no. It gets the animal. Morgan, I think you could be on my side.
It gets the animat seal of approval.
He doesn't know what you're saying.
It's animation.
No. The style, I think this is the kind of style that Phil Lord and Chris Miller want to do. This is what they try to emulate, but not fully succeed into doing. Like, yeah, the Lego movie was great and all, but, like, you know, like, often with some of the jokes is that it does have a bit of a dated feel, like, so even like the fifth time you would watch it, it's like, it's not gonna have as much of an impact as you would in the first. But with the Wizard of Speed and Time, it kind of has this timeless feel. It's like, you know that you can watch it again and again and again. And, like, you know, like, you're going to be into this really fun ride. And, like, so many things is going to happen. There's bound to be things you'll forget what's pretty much going to happen. Like, sure, I remember the Ward Kimball cameo, but don't expect me to remember, like, a lot of the other things that happened. Because so much has happened, yet it's just all fun. And that's
I had an idea.
She has an idea?
India.
It's a joke because of the sound effect. I was gonna say I got an extra life, but I thought that would be too on the nose.
That's a sonic ring. That's not a.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it sounded like an idea light bulb, so.
You didn't play Sonic.
If you, if you get 75 of them and hit the halfway point, you get to the you go to the special stage.
Yeah.
But
although maybe Mike is just waiting for his 100th, so he could get an extra life.
I didn't need to be specific about the reference in order to make a joke about the sound effect. Thank you very much.
I wasn't even paying attention to you guys saying. I was just reading something.
So, but yeah, there.
Join us again, Mike.
I'll probably hear it when I edit this together, so.
But yeah, there is kind of a, there is a little bit of a kind of a sad side to this story. With this film that I really quickly wanted to address. Mike's not the only guy who plays himself or plays a portrait of himself in the film. There's other actors and actresses in there. The guy who played the producer who was going against Mike in the movie was also the producer of the film itself, The Wizard of Speed and Time. And in actuality, after the story goes that Richard Kai, the producer, after making the film, the film was not a successful venture, and not in the box office, but. Apparently, Richard Kai screwed Mike out of the film's profits. And that was part and parcel why Mike's not working so much in film anymore, is because this was his big deal. And, you know, it just seemed to go nowhere. That he was like, I'm done. So the asshole producer in the movie turned out to be an asshole producer in real life.
Tragic irony or poetic justice, you decide.
Well, you can get your jollies by replaying the scene where the toys attack him in the movie.
Yeah.
Watch that on repeat. But, yes, the producer gets attacked by toys. It's that kind of a movie.
Mm-hmm.
But Mike still, at last I checked, he still likes to make appearances at conventions wearing the wizard costume that he wore in the film. He knows that there's a fan base out there for his work, and especially with the internet, there's people coming across it all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh wow, it's a cheesy made movie, but it's a movie that loves movies. Mm-hmm. So Mike, if you're out there somewhere, if you wanted to make something again, you know, I'd be like the first guy in line there. In fact, one of these days I'm gonna hunt down the poster for this movie on Amazon. I'm gonna see if I can get one of my. I'm gonna see if I can get one of those Mike signed wizard posters. Cause you look at my wall, it's kind of naked right now.
You've got more posters in your room than I do.
Well, yeah, but right above my, right next to my bed, there's a space.
Ooh, a space.
Yeah. I think it would go nicely in between the Pixar, the Bugs Life poster there and the Lord of the Rings poster. I think I'd just move that a little bit to the side and put it right in the corner.
You have a giant ass Bugs Life poster?
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Ooh, James.
Right there.
Like, hello, welcome to my room. As you can see,
ooh.
I remember a Bugs Life.
He found it.
eBay.
Well, Kelly Freese is the one that signed it, apparently.
Kelly Freese.
No, but Oh, also, I just want to add one more thing. Mike, if you are watching this and you are actually going back into making movies, James here, he can help you with some stuff. He's a good guy.
Oh, thanks.
He can make good stuff.
Can you hook me up, James?
Yeah.
Mike, if you are watching this, I can make a good story. Yes. I really have a good one, trust me.
Also, Mike, I can do some pretty good voice work for you. Yeah, I got some good pro equipment, trust me. It'll be top quality. I can do whatever voice you want.
Whore yourself out.
Not that, Mike.
Mike, we're already hired from you. We're talking to the wizard. Jet lag.
That's what I was referring to.
I'm talking to the jet lag. Actually, I'm not talking at all, but...
That's what you did. You're holding yourself out to him.
Mike, did you have anything else to say, or...?
I did want to mention another cameo that I noticed in the film. I did some research on the film beforehand, before we watched it, and I was like, oh, this guy's in this film? For those Miami Vice fans out there, Philip Michael Thomas is in this film playing a cop. There's a scene where these fake guys pretending to be cops steal their cop car, and him and his partner has to find the cop car in the film. And they're both named Mickey and Minnie, and their dog in the backseat is named Pluto, so it's another Disney reference in there for you. But yeah, because of this role in this film, he later on got his role in Miami Vice. Because during the interview, apparently, they asked Philip, have you played a cop before? And he said, yes, I have played a cop before. And this is the result of it. So, that was pretty
And
cool.
history was made.
That's what I thought. I was like, that was pretty cool. I was like, that's pretty damn good. Speaking of Disney, the only Disney film in this podcast, Matt Brunet has it. And it's older than all our films combined, because it's from the 40s. The only 40s film.
Yep. Funny enough, I already, not too long ago, I already mentioned this when I did a top 10 favorite Disney films for my 5th anniversary of just making videos. And coincidentally enough, why not I repeat that again for the 2nd anniversary of this video? I am talking, of course, of the Walt Disney 1940 classic, Fantasia. Now, Fantasia truly is the definition of a movie that's unlike anything you have ever seen, unlike any other movie there is out there. It doesn't really have a narrative plot, but more of an artistic, point. Basically, the whole concept of Fantasia is pretty much taking classical music and combine it with the art of Disney animation to combine into something that's completely unique and completely on its own. And it truly is wonderful because it explores every single aspect that you can do. Tokata and Fugue, the one that started in Fantasia, pretty much that's the it shows you in a more abstract way. There's not necessarily any familiar visuals or stuff like that. It's just lines and shapes and all that stuff, just coinciding with the music. There is also the slice of life where you just see the ordinary lives of extraordinary worlds. That could rather be... hold on a sec. I just want to remember things by the soundtrack. This could come from the Pastoral Symphony, the Dance of the Hour, or Night on Bald Mountain. Or then there's also of course the narrative structure with Sorcerer's Apprentice, which, interestingly enough, that's the one that started the whole Fantasia project, because this originally started out just as the Sorcerer's Apprentice because Walt Disney wanted to save Mickey's popularity because he was being overshadowed by his other projects like The Silly Symphonies and Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. But one of the things that really does make it one of my favorite movie of all time is pretty much this is the film that emphasizes how animation is a form of art. Basically, just turn like take animation like when you take animation combine it with classical music, like there's no other way to explain it other than it's just art. And basically how they coincide together, and it turns into something like something that you've never seen before. And I remember there was at one point I went on a special museum at Disney, and I remember seeing they were showing one of the segments of Fantasia, like just in backstage as one of the expeditions of the not expeditions, but like one of the things that they want to show, and it felt right. It felt like that's where it would belong, like because this can pretty much be equivalent of a painting or something like that. It really is a concept of animation that is so interesting. Like it's something that combines it very, very well, and it really takes animation to a whole new level. And it's definitely one of the greatest. I need a new light bulb. One of the most beautiful animated features there is out there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've already gone into to depth before about how I felt about Fantasia. It's one of those cases where I think you grow to have more respect for it as you get older. I remember seeing it at some sort of limited re-release when I was a kid, and to be honest, when I was 7, 8, it really didn't do much for me. And then the ending, the Night on Bald Mountain sequence, was just terrifying for me. But
James,
I look back.
James. Did you have mashed potatoes tonight?
No, we didn't have any mashed potatoes.
Good.
Long story there. I recall this film as one of my particularly the Night on Bald Mountain sequence as one of my great childhood scares because of just how over the top and horrifying it was, but I love the scene now, obviously. You know, it's something you could put on every Halloween and not be disappointed. There's an interesting story, if I can find it somewhere in here. I got this. Matt, you have this book.
Oh, the book! I want it! I want it!
Yeah, there's. Oh, you don't have this book?
I have a few.
You don't have this
book,
Matt?
I got Eric Goldberg's book, and I got. I have a few others. I got Eric Goldberg's book. I got the Animator Survival Kit. I don't have that one. I want it.
When's your birthday?
October 5th.
Oh, okay, well,
sometime to get the book and send them.
Yeah, there's an impressive story about this film that is recalled in this book, The Illusion of Life. The final shot in the movie, the one that tags off immediately. After the Night on Bald Mountain, there's a scene where they show a bunch of church folks singing Ave Maria, walking through the night, early morning, as it were, and sounds like, wow, that storm is outside's pretty bad. It sounds like Night on Bald Mountain out there. The ending shot is a tracking shot that goes through a church and and goes all the way through to the other end where there's, you know, beautiful sunshine coming up. And there's this was a scene like nothing that they'd done before. You know, they're traveling through the church and there's light coming down through the windows, and you think when you look at this, this would be so easy now with computers, but this was all hand drawn, and this was all a combination of hand drawn and stop motion with a multi-plane camera. So they had to build a special dolly just for this, and it took them about countless hours. You know, they had all the layers of the different pieces of the church drawn on these different glass panes, and the camera had to move along the track 1 centimeter at a time to get each frame. And so you can imagine that took forever to make. But after it was done, Matt?
Well, I just wanted to add that with Fantasia, they did, like, the innovations they did is just countless, because, like, there are so many things in there that they had to do. Like, they pretty much had to innovate a lot of techniques in order to achieve, especially, like, a lot of examples can be found in the Nine on Bald Mountain sequence. It's crazy. All the different techniques. So, and like that's another additional thing that I'd like to add is how crazily innovative they had to do for many of the animations in Fantasia.
Yeah. What happened there was, once they were done with this multi-plane tracking shot, they got back the film, they looked it over, and they had to redo it all.
Ooh.
Because the camera lens was too wide. So when they played back the film, they didn't just see the mats, they could see the area beyond that. And they could see animators working at light speed around the edges of the frame.
Oh no, this doesn't look right. Quick, we gotta redo this. We don't have no time. In that case, we have to use ludicrous speed.
Yeah. Now, you know what
look, it's real special effects.
Now, you know what I was thinking, actually? It's like, you just see in the middle it's Ave Maria, and then you see everything else is just speeding up like it's freaking Twice Upon a Time.
Yes!
Meanwhile, in the world of sin...
What is this sex toy doing here?
So that's where the nuns are going. They're trying to beat that up.
It explains the phallic symbols at night on Bald Mountain.
Walt, we forgot to raise the nipples.
Yes. What? You forgot to raise the... You raised the nipples in that one scene with the unicorns, but not... No, not unicorns.
Centaurs.
Centaurs. Yes. Disney boobies. But, they reshot everything, and there was actually a point where they did take a break so that Walt... And they broke everything down so that Walt could play tennis in that same room. I guess he really needed to play tennis. But, this was all being done within a week of the film's premiere in New York. So they had to get this shit done. They were going to get this shot done no matter what. And So they've completed the shot. They rushed off to the guys at Kodak or whoever the film developers were for this. It comes back and everything's fine. So we got less than a day now before the premiere. This means the final shot in Ave Maria had to have one of their guys fly the film over there. And once in New York, they very cheaply spliced that shot in at the last minute. Ooh. Before the premiere. So the glorious Ave Maria shot going to the church, that was a last minute addition. And look at what they had to go through to get that.
That was literally 4 minutes before it premiered. 4 hours. 4 hours. Sorry, four hours.
That's 4 minutes, so that would be an accomplishment.
Yeah, no, it was 4 hours. I apologize.
I just want to add one more thing. I just realized, like, there are so many things I love about Fantasia, but there's just another one that I love about it is the factor of how it took risks. And, like, mm-hmm. like I said, this is a movie unlike any other, and you are never going to see something like this appear again. You are never going to see Disney make something as terrifying, like, or as freaky or as grotesque and graphic as Night on Bald Mountain.
Sunflower.
It's kind of
sad. The black cinerate.
It's kind of sad because Walt Disney didn't want to make...
There are more black characters in the future.
It's kind of sad because Walt Disney did want to make a number of these movies. And I'm sorry if you touched upon this already. I was gone. But like, you know, the movie didn't do very well, and then they didn't make any more like him, and then decades and decades later, by popular demand, they made Fantasia 2000 and that bombed too, so they're not going to try that again. There's no Fantasia 3000 around the corner.
They've got these little stories that come around every once in a while, like the little match girl that sort of follow the Fantasia formula one at a time, but that's
all we're keeping.
Destinio, which was a collaboration with Salvador Dali, Destino, which didn't go too far, and then they resurrected that for the DVD and the Blu-ray.
Technically that would count as one of them. Well, it's not really for the DVD and Blu-ray. That was that came out somewhere in 1999 or 2000, like somewhere in the early 2000s. Like, it just so happened that in the DVD Blu-ray they also add that in, plus a little documentary about about the making of that short and also the whole history of things.
Mm-hmm.
If you guys ever have the Fantasia Blu-ray and DVD, you should check out that documentary. It's really interesting.
All right, because I did see the Destinio short, and it's going to sound really weird, but for some weird reason, whenever I see the short, there's a certain song I play to it. It's like right after the credit, at the very moment, I play Bittersweet Symphony, and it syncs with it.
The what?
It's a bittersweet symphony. This life.
No, I didn't hear you correctly. Don't worry about it. Okay, yeah.
This is the final scene in the film.
No. It's a short.
No, it's a short. It was supposed to be a movie, but Walt Disney thought it was way too random because of baseball, and eventually, 90 years later, Roy E. Disney decided to collaborate with Disney's animators in France in order to finish it up.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a true story, by the way. Yeah. That's a true story. Walt Disney canned the whole project because, like, having baseball in there is just too random.
And there was only, like, 17 seconds they completed, which was these two tortoises, which you saw in Fantasia 2000 as well.
Yeah. Like the two torsos, like, coming together. Mm. Yep. No. Mm.
For me personally, I saw Fantasia as a kid, and while I didn't really think too much of it, I thought it was a beautiful film. Like, if I wanted something that was just, you know, interesting and quiet and unique, I'd put it in. I'd watch it. I wouldn't mind. It was part of the Disney criteria. And the Alamo is that if whatever I had on my VHS shelf, I'd watch it. If it was on television, I'd deal with it. And of course, later as an adult, I'd find the anthology set. I'd watch that as well. And while it's not one of my favorite Disney films, I still regard it as a good movie nonetheless. I find it interesting how critics were so split on that film, because on one hand, it was a concert feature, and on the other hand, it was a movie. So they didn't know whether to treat it as a concert piece or a movie. So you had the movie people saying, well, it's hard to see if this is an actual movie because it's all over the place and it's strange and surreal. And then you had the music people literally criticizing this movie, saying why would they have this musical piece being viewed as this kind of interpretation? Why have the dinosaurs, you know, with the Rite of Spring and stuff like that? And the way I see it, it's an interesting variation to see one's interpretation of taking music to pictures, which we don't see that often. They tried that with Fantasia 2000, and I think that was a little too cutesy, in my opinion.
The problem with Fantasia 2000 is that they tried a little more of the narrative style more than art, and like they tried to make more cartoons.
It was definitely more contemporary and less artistic in that case. And with Fantasia, it was definitely very, very artistic. In fact, I say that's a better example of an artistic film, because it's taking the basic medium of what it's like when you listen to music, what images come to your mind, and this is sort of an artistic interpretation of that idea when you're in there in a concert listening to all this kind of music. And it goes back to my theory, this is an artistic film, because it's proving that theory to the best, and it's a concert feature, so I can't argue there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
yeah,
the
thing. I guess if you're a musician, you know, some folks would probably be pretty hardcore and say, yeah, the Nutcracker suite is not supposed to go to dancing fairies. Oh, wait a minute.
Flowers.
But flowers and fairies. Oh, here it is. Did they complain at all with the Sorcerer's Apprentice sketch? Because, as far as I'm concerned, that follows the story to a T.
Well, the Sorcerer's Apprentice sketch is pretty much, that's the one that started the whole project. That's how it all began. And basically, Walt Disney wanted to try something new with Mickey Mouse. And like, and by the way, the contemporary Mickey Mouse design that we all know today—that's the that actually started in Fantasia. Beforehand, it was this design. But then Fantasia came in and like gave him a new look.
Uh huh. So that's the birth of the modern Mickey.
Yeah, pretty much.
So here's what I wanted to show you guys. This is a diagram of the horizontal plane that I was talking about.
Oh yeah, with additional backgrounds and stuff. The multiplane camera.
Mm-hmm. So this had to be invented for this movie. Pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
The text here says. Diagram and the layout manual, camera crane devised for the final shot in Fantasia. Amazing effects were obtained by painting large images on glass panels and moving the camera slowly through them. Pictures taken from the Ave Maria section. There you go. And over here you got. This is the final result.
Yep.
Hours worth of work went into this really, really basic shot. But that's
a really pretty basic shot.
Yes.
It was worth it.
Yeah. I say so.
By the way, on a curious whim, is anyone familiar with the Clair de Lune segment?
Clair de Lune? Oh, wait. You're referring... That's the one in... I'm trying to remember. Make My Music or
it's
Melody Time?
It was later turned into Blue Bayou for Make My Music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the one like where we see a crane, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm familiar with that. It's a crane.
You think they could have kept that in?
That's honestly a really good question.
Because that's the one that started the whole idea for Walt saying, you know what, why don't we reissue Fantasia and add segments or delete segments or add new stuff to it. And I think it would have been a fun idea. Again, playing it off of the concert feature idea.
It would be an interesting addition. Because this is one that tries something different, which is more the real... Like I said, it's a crane. And we just see a crane. But then again...
But it's beautiful.
Yeah, exactly. It would be an interesting point of view, how we see the crane. I'd say, honestly, give it a shot to see how it would go. In fact, you know, come to think about it, that would be a really interesting addition. Because...
It's only a 5-minute sequence, and the movie's only 2 hours.
Because, Fantasia has already established many elements of the fantasy. We never got a lot of the aspects of reality. And that would be an interesting point of view to see, how it would interpret, how they try this art into, with a realistic manner. Give animators something, try to recreate something realistic. And so, I'd say give it a shot. I'd say give it a shot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I was a kid, I thought Fantasia was really boring. Okay. Nowadays, looking back Nowadays, looking back at the film, I can appreciate it a lot more for what it is, as this artistic piece, as opposed to a movie in its own right. But when I was a kid, I was used to more simple stuff, you know. I was used to films with plots. Although when I was really little, I did watch these Baby Einstein videos, which kind of had a similar thing in that they were pretty visual pieces matched with classical music. Have you guys heard of that?
Baby Einstein, yeah.
It was something that I watched when I was 2 or 3. Anyway, it sort of put me in mind of that, which gave me, 7-year-old me the idea that this is for babies. This is for, 2-year-olds who just like pretty colors. This isn't any kind of real movie. Because I didn't get it then, you know? And it's kind of funny because Disney back then, they didn't necessarily market their films towards kids. You know? Because animation was such an early thing and it hadn't developed that stigma yet. Fantasia was a movie for everybody. It wasn't until, the 60s where Disney began to market itself just towards kids. So it kind of... I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing that the movie didn't reach me as a kid in the same way that it does as an adult. It's just not an expected thing when you think of the way people know Disney now. And that's all I have to say about Fantasia.
Mm-hmm. That's the thing with Fantasia. It's the first time you see it, that's the catch of it. It's the first time you see it, of course, you're not going to understand it because, it's dressed. This is not, like I said, this is not really a movie. So this isn't really, what the hell is it? It's it's just a bunch of weird cartoons with Beethoven. I don't know.
I don't know about that. I mean, if I'd seen it, for the first time as an adult, I think I would have understood it pretty fast.
But it depends. But hold on. This is the kind of movie that you give it time. Give it time to think about it. It's what is it about? Or at least... have an understanding of the movie before coming in. You gotta get it.
Leave your brain at the door.
No. This is where the brain stays. This is what
No. That's what I meant to say. Leave your brain at the door and just appreciate for the artistic value it is.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you're looking at a movie, you're looking at plot, story, and logic. This is the movie where plot and story don't matter.
Well, the brain can still appreciate things like artistic integrity and animation style. It's not a stupid movie. It's not doing anything immature or simple.
I meant it as a figurative speech.
No, I know, that figurative speech is meant for something else, you know?
It's the figure of speech.
Let me try a new one. it's a feast for the eyes.
Yes. There you go. Much better. No, because, like,
body parts.
Because, like, I can do it at the door. That's,
oh,
like,
these cinemas are doing
the
something.
The brain will love Fantasia.
Where the fuck is Mike?
Woogie Loves, on the other hand, just it just wanted GTFO the head.
Hey, Mike. Hey, yo, Mike.
Mike turned into a keyblade.
Mike.
Did he say where he was going, and was I just ignoring him again?
He's been taken! He's been lifted up!
He's been mic-napped.
He's up in our heads in a million pieces.
We'll never know what his favorite movie is.
So the thing is
that... Oh my god!
Oh my god, he's a voice!
He's alive!
They turned you into a voice, man!
It's either that or they turn you into a wall. Or a keyblade.
Okay.
Okay, he got an extra life, so he's coming back now, right?
They turn him into a phone.
I'll send him a life.
Let me explain my spiel about Fantasia, at least. Just give me a sec.
You're out of box.
What are you even doing? Are you in the bathroom or something?
Oh, if I was in the bathroom, I would take my laptop with, like, James does.
James.
That would make
there's
really
a lady present, though.
That would make interesting episodes.
I will have.
Well, yeah, Jade has that. Jade's that, yeah, but Jade's
really good.
But so just give me a sec, all right? I'm just stretching, all right? I'm just off side of the camera. It's just calm the fuck down.
You decided to walk away from the podcast to stretch your damn self. That's unfunctional, Mike.
I went to the bathroom. I'm warranted a bathroom break in this podcast. I said this in a previous episode. I don't remember which one.
Mike, are you wearing pants? Are you wearing pants?
Of course I am. What? Oh, I just walked in the shot and you see my junk.
Oh, you're the only one here who is.
Jeez. So, as for... God, you guys keep distracting me.
Speaking of eye candy...
Mike, come see what you're missing.
I'll probably...
You'll enjoy it even more without the
camera. That was the sound of somebody's erection going off.
Boom! Calm down! Sonic is in my bedroom, right? He's playing with his rings and it's pissing me off.
Yay!
Would you stop?
You know why, guys, you know why Sonic is there? He's just snooping as usual!
I swear, if you do it one more time, Morgan, I will. I can't say it now. I kept laughing. Okay. For Fantasia, I have not seen the whole thing through and through. I've only seen the segments of The Sorcerer's Apprentice and Night on Bald Mountain. So those are the two iconic ones, of course. I was like... But honestly, I prefer Night on Disco Mountain. Thank you very much. But
oh yes, I love that the track they did for Saturday Night Fever.
Yep.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. That's actually really really cool.
Yeah,
which like, later
I think...
disco version.
Which later became the basis for When I Get You Alone by what's that guy? The guy that sings Blurred Lines.
Really?
Robin Thicke?
I never heard that song. Robin Thicke?
Yes.
I should check that out then.
When I get you alone, when I get you alone.
Jesus Christ. Is every song he makes creepy?
I admit it has a nice ring to it.
Okay, so every Robin Thicke song in existence is creepy. That's what you're telling me, James.
Yes.
I swear.
My hands are right here.
So Sonic is like right under you right now.
But you gotta admit, Mike, these ladies here, they have a nice
Sonic
ring to it.
Sonic is over there, and he just touched his rings.
Yep. This is what you're missing out on, Mike.
So, yeah, so that's why...
Too busy enjoying Sonic.
Those two are just...
They're not fluid.
Would you? I swear. Come on.
That's what you like about Sonic, though. He's got that one big boob right in the center.
Are you sure about that boob? Because for some people, that's no good.
So, my film is going back to the 80s. We're going back to the 80s for the rest of the episode, and this film introduced me to the whole 80s cheese when it comes to 80s movies. You know, it's so cheesy, so bad, it's good kind of thing.
Oh dear.
It came out in 1986. It's called The Golden Child, featuring Eddie Murphy. This is a film where the situation was that at Paramount, Eddie Murphy was like looked at for a role in Star Trek IV: The Voyage Home, and there's something wrong, you know, something work out for Eddie Murphy, and he decided to do this film called The Golden Child, and he later on regretted the decision. So The Golden Child go on.
I was just gonna say, so this is kind of like Eddie Murphy's Wild Wild West.
Yeah, you can say that. You can say that, yes. This is Eddie Murphy's Wild Wild West, yes.
Apparently everybody needs to have one.
One little mistake and they regret it for the rest of their life. The Golden Child...
What about Arthur Earth, though?
Oh, he didn't choose After Earth over The Matrix, is the difference there.
Yeah.
Like, it's one thing to make a bad movie. It's another to make a bad movie when you could have made a better movie.
Yeah, exactly. You could have been in a better role.
Wait, he was going to be in The Matrix?
Will Smith, yeah. As Neo.
What?
Yeah.
But the storyboards all look like Keanu Reeves.
But that was before Keanu Reeves.
And yet we got Cowboy Curtis?
That's true.
Anyways, a little fun fact. John Carpenter was supposed to direct The Golden Child, but he turned it down and ended up working on a project called Big Trouble in Little China. And he rushed to finish the film in order to compete with or have an early release than The Golden Child. This came out the same year. And they do have similar themes with the Chinese culture and all that stuff. The Golden Child, pretty much, in my opinion, should have been what Beverly Hills Cop 3 should have been. I got a weird theory, but I'll talk about that later. The Golden Child has Eddie Murphy in L.A., which, after seeing The Wizard of Speed and Time, we noticed the similar themes between both films because they're both shot in L.A., and I was like, oh, we've seen that shot before.
Oh, look, it's the Rocky and Bullwinkle statue. Where did we just saw that in the other movie.
Thanks for quoting me, James.
Yep. Direct quote from Matt, personally. Eddie Murphy plays this guy named Chandler. This is way before Friends. And he is... I don't know how his position is as a job, but he looks for lost children. He looks for lost children, you know. He's doing his job looking for lost children. And we're set up that there's this Tibetan child, the Golden Child, who has mystical powers, gets kidnapped. And Eddie Murphy gets hired to find this Golden Child, and he gets into this big hoo-ha with this big adventure where he meets these Tibetan Chinese people. You know, there's a snake woman, and there's, you know, they have to, you know, go to Tibet to get this knife, and this villain played by Charles Dance, who you may know from Last Action Hero, and for those Game of Thrones fans out there, he was in as well. He is just fantastic as the villain in this film. I mean,
shocker.
It's shocking enough. He's good at villainous roles.
A dance for Charles Dance.
He's like this. How would I say this? He's like this mystical, like demon. He's like a demon, pretty much, because at the end of the film, spoiler alert, he turns into this demon, which is all stop motion, which looks pretty cool at the time. I mean, it was cheap. The effects in this film alone are cheesy beyond cheesy. And mind you, this film did become a box office success, but not as big as Beverly Hills Cop for Paramount. So Paramount's like, it's not as big as Beverly Hills Cop.
I will challenge you on the effects here. See, I thought they were on par with other movies like Ghostbusters and Fright Night.
You know what? I'll take you up on that. I should take that back then. I wouldn't say, yeah, they're on the same level as those films, but in reality, when you watch the film, in my point of view, it's just like there's like a couple of shots where it's like, oh, that was cheesy. There was a couple of transformation scenes. Like, they could have done that a little bit better, you know, when Charles Dance does transform into a rat at one point, and it's like, Splinter, is that you?
Still, we can all agree there is one good special effect. The dancing Pepsi can.
Yes, the dancing Pepsi can.
There's a point in the film where the golden child...
Damn it, man, you took my moment. Pepsi can.
Yeah, at one point in the film... While being kidnapped, the golden child animates this Pepsi can and does, like, a tap dance to putting on the Ritz to entertain a lackey. It's like, Pepsi can.
Yes, it brings it to life. It sort of unravels itself into the stick figure form and starts doing...
It's just like a 30-second or minute, like, promo for Pepsi. Buy our products!
It was such a great, it was such a great advertisement, though, you know.
Why couldn't that be their new
like their little mascot?
A mascot. It's like you just animate a Pepsi can. It wouldn't be so. It's so simple.
Like I can so see that. I could so see that thing somewhere in like a billboard in New York City. Like it's just there, you know.
Yeah. But there's.
It's their Pillsbury Doughboy.
There's this one shot, it's like the only effect that actually works, is that Charles Dance is like an assistant or higher hand of this other demon, where you see there he's like transporting into like hell or something, and there's like it's like a green screen effect. It's like so beautiful. And little fun fact is that if you hear the demon voice in the background, it's Frank Welker.
Oh, that makes sense.
Oh, that shot. Yes.
Yeah, that shot.
The one where he
sounds like
the Cave of Wonders and Aladdin.
He sounds like Megatron.
Yeah, so that's why it's a little fun fact. It's like that's because you got Charles Dance, he's good. And Frank Welker, that's a bonus for you if you love this film. And then Eddie Murphy in this film. It's like all like ad-libbed at one point because I don't think it's not scripted.
And it was in the
80s,
so you know it was good, Eddie Murphy.
Yes.
I want a knife, please.
His performance in this film is golden, pun intended. He's the only reason, not the only reason, but one of the reasons why I love this film. It's like, oh, I love Beverly Hills Cop, and this is like the second outing. It's like, oh my god, this is fantastic. Oh, this is like one of the golden treasures that you should love. I mean, if you love Eddie Murphy's like ad libs for Beverly Hills Cop in 48 Hours, or even his stand up, this is perfect.
I'm always game for a good Eddie Murphy movie. I still think that Eddie Murphy has the potential to be funny. He just hasn't gotten a good script in a while.
Right. And this shows it pretty much because he is funny. I laughed every time Eddie Murphy said something, and these guys can tell. I was laughing my ass off. There is a like a forced love interest in here, and
of
you can tell it's very forced. Like they end up together at the end. I was like, of course that's gonna happen.
Movies aren't allowed to exist without love interests.
Well, here's the thing. I was the one knock against the film that I had was feeling how forced the romance was, and then I looked back and I thought about my choice for a favorite film, and I realized, you know what? Maybe there is a romantic subplot in there as well. Maybe that's a little bit forced.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I just
so I shouldn't
that.
Really say much, you know.
Even Dead Poets Society had a little romantic subplot in there that was honestly the most unbearable part about it. Mr. I haven't seen the movie, but like there was this subplot where this guy met this girl who was in another school, and he like fell madly in love with her, but she had a big tough bully boyfriend, and yeah, it was so not important. Anyway, sorry, I made that about me briefly.
It's okay. So, what was it? It was Eddie Murphy, Charles Dance, Frank Welker. I had five things I liked about this film so much. The cheesiness, and of course, the soundtrack. The soundtrack is a biggie for me. Like, when it comes to 80s films, I love the soundtrack. I love the soundtracks no matter what. Beverly Hills Cop has a great soundtrack. This film has a great soundtrack. The first time I watched it, I automatically searched online for the main theme of the film and downloaded it right away, and I listen to it like constantly whenever I have the chance.
Another thing you're gonna like about it, I presume, is the title character gender swap.
Oh yes.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I don't really think about that too much, but yeah, that's kind of like that.
It's kind of an interesting. A bit of trivia is to look at the film, and you're meant to think that the character of the Golden Child is pretty much said to be in the film that it's supposed to be a boy, but it's in fact played by a girl.
Yeah, yeah, and that's the thing. That's a little trivia fact, because normally when people see it, it's like, wait, he's supposed to be a boy, but he's played by a girl, and it's yeah. Just, I was like, wow, really? I never noticed.
Yeah, it's like there are a lot of times, like it definitely covers the fact that it's a girl. But like, if it's like it's more if you look really closely, then you can see a few traces of girl in her in the Golden Child. But other than that, it's relatively played off well.
Yeah, it was pretty interesting with that part. Oh,
it's not like you couldn't tell either with the credits J.L. Reet.
Yeah, that's true.
Right.
Yeah.
The thing that I really hate that is with the DVD release, it's part of the widescreen collection. And, of course, you think of widescreen, it's like this big, but it's like this small when you watch the film. So it's just like... Could you just get it on Blu-ray? Could you get it at, like, a 30th anniversary DVD soon or something? Like, it's something. Like, I hate just watching the film like that.
Well, usually the better your obscure movie...
Right, yeah.
The less likely it is to get a proper DVD release.
Right.
It's a part of time.
But yeah, just like this is the film that just introduced me to, you know, the cheesiness that was the 80s, and that got me into what 80s films. Just like, of course, I was a fan of Eddie Murphy because I saw Beverly Hills Cop, and I was like, The Golden Child, what is this? And I saw it, and I was like, okay, that was hilarious and fun. It's a fun thrill ride.
Something but bananas in the tailpipe.
Bananas in the tailpipe, good times, and definitely shop.
Good times. For me, I enjoyed it, but it seems to be pretty strange when it's going back and forth and being this modern-day Raiders of the Lost Ark and this Beverly Hills Cop kind of scenario. I mean, there are points where it does sort of shine on, but I'd like to have a little more of those Raiders moments. I read up in an article of CineFantastic that they actually had a lot of stuff with that devil creature at the end, but it got heavily cut down. And there's a lot of reasons why. The rumor goes is that it was Eddie's doing because he said it was too fantasy-like and they wanted to bring out the humor more. The other reason is that the special effects didn't look so good at the time. In fact, according to an article from Cinefex, a magazine issue I highly recommend that's all about special effects and breaking down the technicals, they mentioned that at one point they're going to have like this big transformation scene that was very elaborate and extravagant, where you see the guy like melt in this form and these wings rip out of his back, which would have been really cool, but they cut it because it didn't match the matting plates of the actual stop motion devil or something like that. And it's a shame because I would love to see a lot of stuff like that.
Now that would have been amazing, because when you see the film and the transformation from Charles Dance to this creature, it just like it's like breaking off. It's like,
And another thing too, what is up with a few seconds of the Cobra Lady? I mean, honestly, we see like 5 seconds of her, and yet the claymation Snake Man in Dreamscape gets a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Of screen time,
yeah,
and yet even
and
that
the
looks
Pepsi
like
Pepsi Man was more important too, right?
Yeah. Why is that more unique when we see like 3 seconds of this unique special effect that was hiding behind a curtain all this time?
Yeah, and the snake lady you don't see until later on is just like a snake body with a like a matted on like woman. It's very cheesy. It's like one of the.
I'll be honest with you guys. I don't know about unique, because the first time I saw her, I was just there watching, like, did they go Ray Harryhausen had a garage sale?
Right.
Burn.
But not to say that it was bad. It's just,
no,
I don't know.
Just,
I've seen this before.
I do have this theory I have in my head. Like, every time I watch this film, it's like, okay, this should have been Beverly Hills Cop 3. Like, I think about this in my head every time I watch it. It's like, okay, so it's after Beverly Hills Cop 2, he moves to L.A., changes his name, has a new job, and this is his new adventure. And then he has this happy ending with this chick and the golden child. It's way better than Beverly Hills Cop 3.
Hey, I say we go to Vegas and we become magicians, you know what I'm saying?
that's why I...
Have you ever heard of Star Search?
Have you heard of Star Search? Oh, so dated in the film.
Hey, James, you're online.
Yeah. I'm here.
I just got notified of that.
Me
Good
too.
Good to know, Skype. Thank you. Apparently, James is online. Did you guys know that? I had no idea.
I thought James had supper right now.
Anyways, yes, the golden child.
Ooh, breaking news! The genie's a meme now.
What? The genie's a meme? This is my reaction to Disney Channel today.
Oh God. Anyways, yes. In a nutshell, the golden child is my number one favorite film I watch whenever I feel like I want to see some Eddie Murphy. There is one little last fact. There's a scene in the airplane when they're going back home, and he's listening to this, like, Tibetan music, and he's singing along, and he says, Eddie Murphy is a really cool man. It's like kind of meta right there.
Yeah.
It was very nice. Like, in this universe, Eddie Murphy exists?
Yeah, you know, I didn't realize... I'm looking at that picture, and I didn't realize that Jafar's facial expression in that clip was so funny. Because all my attention's been on Genie this whole time, but Jafar has a funny face, too.
Well, yeah.
Just thought I'd throw that out there. Underappreciated facial expression.
Yeah, Robin Williams steals the show.
Anywho, let's... oh, sorry about that. My voice a little groggy there for a second. Oh, my. Anyways. Last but not least, saving the best for last, Morgan's favorite film.
So, for me, it was easy, but at the same time, it was a little difficult because I have, like, not one, not 10, not 20, but 50 favorite films. And I have this list on my computer, and I consider these movies that, you know, got me into filmmaking in general, or that I hope to, whether or not that happens. But regardless, these are the movies that really got me into the magic and power of celluloid in question. And
easy. It's hard for him to get it.
And it was hard because you mentioned that we were originally going to do two choices. So it was going to be this one and Twice Upon a Time.
Right.
So unfortunately, when we were limited to one, I said, well, I have to talk about the one that really inspired me into appreciating movies in question. So I had to drop Twice Upon a Time. So that's a little shout out to that one. So picture this. You're a kid in BJ's warehouse sale. And you're a big film collector. At the time I was always collecting VHS tapes, whether it was like Disney movies or episodes of like Tailspin or stuff like that. And the big thing at the time was Little Nemo in Slumberland. So I'm all like, oh yay, this movie's like selling out and stuff, it's gonna look so cool, there's all this amazing animation, I've seen trailers for this, it's gonna be awesome, I'm gonna look for this copy. And it's not there. It's literally sold out.
Well.
And I just couldn't believe it. I was like, oh, this nice animated movie I wanted to see that I saw trailers of looks so unique. And then I looked about because I always don't like to leave empty-handed. And I noticed there were these boxes containing another VHS movie. And it had Jim Henson in the title. And I said, okay, I like the Muppets. I know who Jim Henson is. Okay, give it a watch, see. So I get my grandmother to purchase it, we go home, I watch it, and immediately I get like an overwhelming feeling that I've never seen before from any Disney film or anything at the time. I'm just so amazed at the visuals and just the entire environment around it. And from then on in, if it wasn't for The Dark Crystal, I wouldn't be into movies in general.
I knew it was either The Dark Crystal or Labyrinth, because I couldn't
Mirror Mask, I didn't see that one. Labyrinth is a different case. Labyrinth is a different case. I actually sacrificed s'mores to see that one. I was literally in the camper, and the TV was on the Disney Channel, and they said, oh, we have a Jim Henson movie coming on called Labyrinth. And I said, okay, I like Jim Henson, I'll watch this one. Morgan, we're having s'mores. No, that's fine, just save me some. Wow, that was an interesting movie. Any s'mores left? No. At what cost?
So you've resented Labyrinth ever since, is what you're saying. I can understand that.
Dance, magic, dance, magic, dance, magic, dance, magic.
Oh, boy.
No. I liked Labyrinth as a kid. I just still wonder today what the s'mores would have tasted like while watching it.
Right.
I sacrificed s'mores to see Labyrinth. You heard me,
Snooze.
Internet.
Snooze, you're losing.
You heard it here first on Cinema Royale.
Jumping back to Dark Crystal, yeah, it's a very Tolkien, fairy tale-esque storyline. You have this character, Jen, going on a quest to restore the world by means of a crystal shard. I want to say it's a complex story, but it's a little simplistic. There's many themes going on, such as good and evil, that basic storyline. It's very Tolkien-esque. I think that's a better way to put it. But for me, what always stuck with me was just how you've never seen a movie like this in a while. Like, when you take a look at today's medium, there's always CGI films, there's always animated films, live-action movies. Why aren't there puppet films? Why aren't there films where the cast are all just puppets or Muppets or anything of that sort? Or at the very least, trying to use them as a medium of their own, not like Robert Zemeckis and the motion capture films, just literally using nothing but like creatures in a realistic setting. And for this kind of movie, it's easy to put it in animation and do all these things and make it all CGI and stuff. But the fact that Jim really thought that puppetry was an interesting craft to work with, in fact, he was really into the special effect of it all, and that he really put a lot of effort into this film. He had like $15 million financed by it, and it took him 5 to 4 years to make it. Even at one point when the studio he was working for, ITC Entertainment, who was funding it, was going under new management, and the guy didn't like the movie, and he was going to put it in limited release and give it limited advertising and, you know, re-edit it and stuff to make it, like, bomb or commercial or something like that. Jim really believed in that movie. It was, like, his creation. He physically bought that movie out with his own money. He really did. It's just amazing to see just how much, you know, faith and trust he had in this vision, how much he didn't want it to see destroyed, because it's a very emotional, it's a movie that really paces itself on emotion. Like, you really want to see Jen go on this quest and restore the world, especially, you know, realizing his place in the world. You find yourself really intrigued by the Skeksis and how wicked they are, and sort of a very humanistic kind of approach is how they're greedy and gluttonous, and how they're trying to pertain to youth by sucking out the essence of these poor little pod people, which look like potatoes on hand puppets. It's just amazing just to see how the will of imagination can take us to these interesting worlds that we never thought possible. Yes, there's stuff like Star Wars, but with so many human characters, it makes you wonder what it would be like if the humans were aliens to begin with, or at the very least, just like these robotic beings or anything of that much. But, of course, you gotta have human characters so you can connect with them. And, yeah, I can see why the Gelfing characters resemble human characteristics. Yes?
Technically, the characters in Star Wars are aliens because they're not of Earth. Like, I know they look human, but they doesn't necessarily mean they are human, because technically it would be impossible for them to call themselves exactly the same species that we do, what with being from a galaxy far, far away and all.
Okay.
Whatever.
Yeah. I wanted to point that out.
But another thing, too, that's interesting about the Dark Crystal, everything is alive in this film. There's this one scene where we're in a swamp, and, like, there's stuff moving. There's not, like, a tree that's standing still. We got everything. Bugs, all these, you know, rock monsters, this giant Venus flytrap that eats a creature. It's just interesting to see how one person can take us to this different world and say there's no limit to the creative mind, just making all these surreal creations. And this, again, goes to my original argument. You can make a film with such artistic quality and have a story to it. Even if the story isn't really that strong, there's something going to it. There's all these amazing visuals that are pertaining to it. He's using the puppetry, the sets, and the special effects to tell a narrative, and that's where I think this movie is the strongest, in my opinion. And every year when I go to revisit this, I keep saying to myself, it's not going to hold up. It's not going to work well. There's going to be something that I notice that ruins the illusion. And every time I see it, I always see something new to it. I always notice something moving. I always notice something that I've never seen before, like the technical details of the Skeksis' clothing or the extra arms on the Mystics or the Uru, which they were originally called. And to me, I just find it fascinating. That's a movie I can just sit down and just look at every single scene and analyze it, like if it's a certain object or a certain set piece. Because it's just unique to see that there comes a film like this that will never be tempted again, just showing how there's no limitation what we can create.
Mm-hmm. Kind of like Fantasia.
Yeah.
And there you go.
Ooh.
You know, it's, although, it's funny.
Although with Fantasia, it's like, Fantasia is like, it's completely, like, to be fair, like, what I'm trying to say is that the Dark Crystal has a more narrative structure, so it's like an original story. Fantasia is like an original feature film, in a way.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's funny, because Dark Crystal was another movie that I really couldn't appreciate as a kid. It wasn't because I found it boring. It was because it scared the shit out of me.
Okay.
Like, when I was a kid watching, I could not... Even the protagonist characters who were supposed to be the good guys, they were freaking me the hell out, because, like, these are little puppet freaks. Where are the people? I don't understand. That's not even touching on the vultures, which even still kind of scare the shit out of me a little bit.
Geskies.
Yeah. Like, everything in that... There are a lot of things that scared me as a little kid, and most of them were puppets. I don't know what it is. I had no problem with Sesame Street. I loved Sesame Street. I was a Sesame Street addict as a kid, yet most other puppets scared the shit out of me, including the ones in Dark Crystal. Looking
Even
back
the Muppets?
At it now... not all of the Muppets, some of the Muppets.
Okay.
There were some scary... I remember I did not like Crazy Harry.
Oh, come on!
Here's the thing
crazy
about Crazy Harry.
Makes electricity.
Okay, look. When I was 6, I was really stupid. So I didn't understand that Crazy Harry was popping up because people were saying, like, bomb puns. I didn't get the joke. So, from my perspective, Crazy Harry was just popping up at random times to explode my favorite characters. And
it's
it was,
okay to explode.
And I was, like, constantly on edge through the whole show because, like, Crazy Harry could pop up at any time. Any time! I did not like Crazy Harry as a kid. He does not scare me anymore. Nor does some of the... I gotta be honest, the vultures still kind of freak the hell out of me. They're freaky vultures. But, you know, I like the story better now than I did when it scared me. Even though it is kind of a simple little story, it's still, you know, it's a nice story. And it does really fascinate me that they made a movie that was entirely puppets with no human characters. Like, even Labyrinth had human characters, a precious few of them. I don't know about Mirror Mask, because I haven't seen it.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing, too, to consider, the Dark Crystal plays itself on the monomyth, and that is something that's been pretty much the basis for a lot of fantasy films, the hero's journey. And it's not really much of a copying, it's more or less you're taking the formula and doing something different with it. But jumping back to the creatures, even Fizzgig? You were scared of Fizzgig?
Which one's Fizzgig?
The little furry ball that goes...
To be honest, I'm sorry, Morgan. I think Fizzgig is that mouth.
Yeah.
But so innocent. He's just a boyfriend cock blocker, and he was designed that way.
I'll admit
it was intentional.
I'll admit that at first he did freak me out because like he popped out of nowhere, but then like he did grew on me because he really did remind me of my dog. Like, my dog, like, just paint Frizzgig white, and that's my dog.
Is Mirror Mask really not worth seeing at all? Like, even
It gave me a headache.
I never saw it. Some people say they didn't like it. Some people said it was decent. I got nowhere.
You just have to watch the films on your own time and make the decision.
I'm just watching this. I'm just watching Mirror Mask and saying, I'm pissed off because I'm not seeing a single puppet anywhere.
There's no puppets in Mirror Mask? Okay, that's
no
just
puppet.
Weird.
It's all crappy CGI.
What?
No puppets?
Jim Henson doesn't do CGI. Jim Henson never did CGI. He everything was puppets with Jim Henson. That was his thing.
Jada, I concur. When he was doing the Jim Henson Hour, he invented something called the Waldo Puppet, which was a computer-generalized puppet that would be keyed in at real time.
The spirit of freedom!
Even his CGI is still puppetry. Okay.
Yeah. That was, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was in Farscape.
So... That, what you're saying is true. Say it ain't so, James. Say it ain't so.
Okay.
It's so... It's very ugly CGI.
Mm-hmm. Oh, now I know what you're talking... Oh, I just realized I know exactly what you're talking about. It's like, messed up.
Yeah.
It's like what if
Labyrinth was completely uninteresting in any way, shape, or form.
No, it's like Sonic 06 wants to make a Jim Henson game.
I mean, that's really disappointing. I mean, come on, you have, like, creatures in these, like, the Garth and these giant lobster-like creatures, and they're just so believable because there's people in there putting effort and stuff. Even when you have performers doing the Mystics, they couldn't stay in those suits for very long. They could film like a minute of footage and they have to get them out of those suits fast because they would put a sore on their backs. Jim himself said he couldn't even last more than 5 seconds in that thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a... There's no. Something...
I'm Hoggle.
I like Hoggle.
There's something I...
Go ahead.
There's something I usually say every time Morgan and I sit down and watch a Muppet movie or a Jim Henson movie, in this case, together. And every time the credits roll, I always say... That's what happens when you write for fucking felt. It's a reference to back when Jim Henson was doing The Land of Lurch, and one of the SNL writers famously made a statement saying, "I will not write for felt."
And he lynched Big Bird. He had a little Big Bird doll, and he wrapped a blind cord around it, and he hung it.
Mm-hmm. That's how much they felt about his work. But every time you look at... the reason why I say that, though, is in a completely different context. Not out of malice, but out of being thoroughly impressed about... For what I've just seen. The Dark Crystal... is one of those cases. Sure, when I was a kid, I always liked The Labyrinth a little bit better because it had David Bowie and fun
and songs. His boner.
Just the songs.
But I'm kind of with you, Jada, in the sense that actually, when I was a kid, I did find it. I didn't find it scary, but
really?
No.
Wow.
Although the Skeksis designs I find to be the most impressive out of the group.
I agree. Yeah.
I think looking at it, it's just a case of you want to watch this movie, not just see it done, but how it's made. And I think the point where I actually fell in love with this film was watching it when it first came on DVD. It had a nice doggy, nice kitty.
It's a cat. It's a cat.
It's not a doggy.
It's a cat.
I'm sorry. We have kitty. A surprise visitor here.
I'm only looking at
Lexus. Hello, Lexus.
Now you're tiny.
Is her name Kira?
No, her name's Lexus. Come here, Lexus. Come be on TV again.
Like the car?
Come here. Come here. There you are,
nice.
Cutie.
Kitty.
So, yeah, that's not a puppet.
That's real life.
Real life creature.
It shows how people interact with things when they're real, right?
Yeah,
right.
Yes.
And again, jumping back to another example, Wizard of Speed and Time, when we see that movie, we're so engrossed in this universe, Mike, Jit Love is created, and the fact that he's using these special effects to get around his own environment, we are wondering, how did he do that sort of stuff? How is he pulling
right.
this sort of off? When he
right.
goes into the pool and he's underwater and they're looking over and they're like, oh, how is he holding his breath?
He is holding his breath there.
Yeah, right.
He was.
To concur, you have that whole dinner scene with the Skeksis where they're just eating and, you know, conversing and burping and belching. It makes you interesting just seeing how they're interacting with something simple as food. And how they're sort of, you know, talking to each other, you know, those Gartham, they're not going to capture that Gil thing, and one of them is like spaghetti stuck in his mouth. You're just so enticed because of the humanistic qualities they have.
Right.
They're just picking away at their teeth and just munching and being gluttonous and running after, like, a little wind-up furball that's supposed to be dessert. It's just so interesting when you see the technical craft telling the story at play.
Mm-hmm. I think the one part that I always thought was the most... If I had a part in this production, I always thought it would be the most fun to be the guy who was in the Lance Rider costume.
Yes! Yes, the stilts.
Yes, the stilts. because I look, I remember looking at the DVD special features. They showed those guys, you know, on stilts, and they've got, they're walking around on all fours. It's amazing. They're walking around on all fours on stilts. I mean, that's their hands, their feet. They're all hunched over, stilted around, getting. It looks like, and they're probably what, at least 10 feet up. It looks like a full, it looks like a full body workout. It really does. But it also looks like so much fun because they're attached to harnesses, and the cranes that they're on were like 100 feet high, and so they, as you see them running along, they're just bounding and soaring. And it just seems like so much fun to be able to go along at these stilts and go boing, boing. Imagine the things they get paid for. I mean, that's not puppetry. That's having fun. But yeah. I'm still mystified by one effect, and that's the. I want to know how they did. The Mystic's holograms.
I thought you were gonna say the Emperor's death scene.
Oh yeah.
The way he crumbles to ashes.
Yeah, decomposing.
That's another good effect.
It is, yeah.
Yes, it's a like I was saying during the movie, it saves money on cremation.
Yeah, it does. I mean, yeah, the hologram portion of it was like it was popping up, and I was like looking. I was like, what? Huh? How?
I guess I should also briefly bring up, it was a pretty big character who performed in The Dark Crystal. She did the voice. She's unfortunately no longer with us, so I decided to give this little shout-out to her. You probably know who this is. The character of Ogre is interesting, considering she's the nodal wise man that later gets captured. She was voiced by Billy Waitlaw. We might know her better as Miss Baylock.
Billy from what?
Billy Honor Whitelaw.
Honor Whitelaw?
Yeah. Hope I pronounced her name right. She voiced the character of Ogre. You might know her better as Miss Baylock, the demonic nanny in The Omen. Just having that Scottish quality in her voice and that, you know, over-the-top crazy quality just really adds to the character, the fact that she's all of nature and such. She passed away last year, and it's a shame, considering how she was regarded as one of the most foremost interpreters of Samuel Beckett's work for 25 years. She's a very amazing actress, and I just want to give this little shout-out to her, wherever she is. Without her, there wouldn't be an Ogre. We would just have Frank Oz's Yoda, Miss Piggy-ish voice in the character.
You know, there was another character. Oh, God, what's his name? Chamberlain, yeah. He was voiced by the original Jesus in Jesus Christ Superstar. Yeah.
You know, that actually puts that sequence, the scene where they're tearing his clothes off, I see that in a new light now.
I know what you mean.
Let him go. This is the old way. We're not going to put him on the cross.
You're welcome.
We're going to shame him and make him naked. And then we're going to get some selfies posted on Facebook.
That pretty much means that's the new amen. Like we're just going to go into a church.
Yep.
Yes, God is good. God is great. Thank you for the food we ate. Men.
No.
Dear Gelfings, do you like popsicles? I have them here in the temple.
Oh my god, Herbert as a Skeksis. That would have been perfect.
That'd be freaky. He's already old. He fits it. He has, like, the robe and everything.
Oh, hello, champ. Maybe you can come on by to the temple. I can help you take that shard and put it into the dark crystal.
You look like... smell like a gelfling.
Lordy, lordy, lordy.
Maybe you are. Maybe you taste like a gelfling, too.
The dark crystal, I mean, I've seen it before. Yes, I've seen the dark crystal. I was on, like, cable at one point. I was like, okay, I'm gonna watch this. Because I knew Morgan liked it. And yeah. He was, like, talking about it to me at one point. I was like, okay, I gotta watch this. It's fascinating. Just like, you know, it's the puppetry is, like, fascinating. It's like, you don't see a film like this anymore. It's just, like, it's a great fantasy film. I don't normally watch fantasy films. And this is, like, straight up there when it comes to fantasy films.
Try Willow.
It's one of those fantasy films. It's fantastic.
Like I said, I don't normally watch fantasy films. So when it comes to Dark Crystal, I was like, oh my god, nothing can beat Dark Crystal until I see something better.
I think when you do think about it, there's movies today that really try too hard. Jupiter Ascending bombed big time at the box office.
Yeah,
and I think that's because...
I heard that was Battlefield Earth levels of cholera bad.
The problem is that they're focusing more on the environment and less on what to put in that environment. If it was just like this mockumentary, okay, fine. What makes The Dark Crystal unique is that you don't need all this complex storytelling. It's in another world. Boom. There are these creatures. Boom. There's a story. That's all you really need. And if
you
more
know why
movies
that
were
is,
like that...
You know why fantasies become like that, though, right?
Yeah.
It's all Harry Potter's fault. Harry Potter and Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings. Now
he is the chosen one.
We can't have simple fantasy movies anymore. They all have to be big epic sagas.
Yep.
With huge action scenes and a lot of blockbuster appeal. It's sort of enhanced / ruined fantasy forever.
I could save it. I'll tell you after the podcast.
Mm-hmm. If I can give my take onto The Dark Crystal.
Because it was your first time seeing it yesterday.
Yes, yeah, I'll be honest. That is pretty stupid of me, considering how huge of a Muppet fan I am, and I have yet to see The Dark Crystal. Like, I know about it. Like, I know about the history, and it has possibly one of the most interesting behind-the-scenes stories that I've ever heard. Yeah. But I gotta say, The Dark Crystal definitely is one of the greatest examples of movies that's all about the world that it's set in. This is a movie where it's all about this world. The world where you see those six-armed potato guys, or the Skeksis and the Gelflings, and like, you know, all these races, and like how, like, it's really fascinating to look at how they live, the lores, and it, like, it truly is an entire world, like, on its own. And an interesting thing about it is the use of puppetry, because it's extremely rare to see puppetry used in a way that's taken seriously like this. Because nowadays, like, you would think of, like, puppet movies, something like this, right? But, like, you don't see it in a way where it's, like, it's not about comedy, you know, it's not about goofiness or stuff like that. It's pretty much taken seriously in a way where they made, like, believable characters. And that's really what it is. It's, like, it's really about, like, the world and the characters in a way, like, and plus the fact that it's puppetry, it's like, you're never going to see, well, I think that's kind of the theme of this podcast. It's like, you're never going to see anything like this because, like, nowadays with CGI and stuff like that, like, it's like Hollywood is pretty much ball and chain with it. But, like, this one is, like, fully practical effects. And, like, this is an amazing example of, like, many different practical effects. But, Morgan, don't hate me on this, but there is one little issue that I do have with the movie.
That's fine.
It's honestly Jen. Because like the movie is centered so much about the movie, like it's centered around the world. I don't really find Jen to be that interesting of a character, because
Are you saying Jen or Jem?
Jen, the main character, the main girlfriend.
I was gonna complain about how he's truly outrageous.
No, not that Jen. No, but
coming up this year.
The thing with Jen, this year.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
October.
Snuck up on you, didn't it?
What? Anyways, no, but the thing with Jen is, like, because I feel like throughout the whole time, he's just going around, like, just carrying the shard. It's like, I have no idea what I'm doing. It's like...
There was a different cut without the voiceovers, so maybe it would have helped if they didn't have the Blade Runner ADR in there.
Yeah, that and also, I don't know who they got to voice Jen... Because honestly, he's not that much of an actor. Because, like, I know, like, he was performed by Jim Henson, like, which is great. Like, that was fantastic. But, like, whoever voiced that guy, like, he's really not much of an actor. So, and that's...
Looking up right now, his name is Stephen Garlick. He's an actor, radio presenter, and he's currently 55. He was born in 1959. I'm trying to see what else he's done. Oh, James, here's something interesting for you. Jen was a child in Scrooge with Albert Finney.
No. No, but yeah, that's pretty much my only issue with the movie is that the main character is not interesting, but it's explainable because this is a movie that's about the world. It's all about the world. It's not about this one character. The character and the quest that he goes to is just an excuse why we're following him in order to explain this world.
Well, he's the chosen one.
Well, again, to be fair, this film was re-edited quite a bit to meet audience tastes. For example, they originally had a foreign language done for the Skeksis, and they did away with that because audience members were confused, and originally they thought, well, why don't we just put subtitles in there? Well, you kind of have to read them while also seeing the environment at the same time, henceforth why they gave them American-English dialogue. So maybe if they had the original intention placed in there as it was originally was, it could have been a stronger film. I don't know. I still like it for what it is. And now, in a fit of revenge, Matt, I have this very neat question for you, seeing you are a Muppet fan.
Yeah? Oh my god. You already... Okay, just to say, guys, he already did this before. He did two of them.
Well, I didn't see it, so go on, Morgan.
No. This is a different one.
A different Muppet quiz.
Oh. Oh, I had this on the back burner just in case I had a moment like this.
Oh, God.
Who is sexier? Annie Sue or Miss Mousy?
Who in the heck?
Annie Sue? I don't even know what that means.
Can I just research Annie Sue?
Annie Sue sounds sexier, so.
Yeah, look him up.
Miss Mousy, isn't Miss Mousy a mouse?
Yeah.
Just look them up.
And performed by Jerry Nelson.
Hold on. Jerry Nelson.
I'm trying to find...
Who would call him sexy?
Wait, is Anusu a Muppet, or...?
Unless you're willing to take that vampire fetish of yours to outrageous length.
I'll make it easier. They're both Muppets.
Oh, Annie Sue! You mean Annie Sue Morgan! Annie Sue! You said Anusu. What the hell?
No, I said Annie Sue.
I still don't know what that means.
No, okay.
I heard it too. Anisu. I heard it too, Matt.
I heard Annie Sue.
Okay,
you're supposed to say Anna Sue.
I guess I would go with Annie Sue because we're kind of related, especially in the
fool.
Hair department.
You fool!
What?
Miss Piggy!
Oh my god! Oh my god, that's true.
You fool! You fool!
Yeah, but that's a freaking...
You fool!
Now, who is sexier?
You fool!
Oh, man, I love that.
Crap, who was I thinking then?
Well, you guys... Well, you guys have very similar hair.
Wait, then who was I thinking of?
Wait, because there was one pig. There was that one pig that has my hair.
Muppets
and, like,
Tonight. Oh, no.
No. It was in the Muppet Show. It's like she was like a more popular pig, and it's like she's like the new star, and like makes Piggy hates her. You know who I mean?
I have no idea.
No, this is a conversation between Muppet folks.
If you know what Matt's talking about, please leave a comment below.
That's exactly who I was talking about.
Oh.
You know who's sexy? Jane Russell.
That is Annie Sue. That's exactly what I was talking about.
Because
okay, that's her name then.
There are no sexy Muppets.
What are you talking about?
What are you talking about? There's no sexy girl Muppets. There's no sexy boy Muppets. There's no sexy Muppets.
What about
Excuse
Janice?
Excuse me, but I just want to mention, Morgan, I am right. Because that's exactly what I was talking about.
That's what I'm
saying.
Why are
you saying you fool to me? Would you rather do Miss Mousy then?
See how sexy she is.
Okay, we have gone off the tangent.
Look, I wanted to find an opportunity to say you fool.
Okay, fine.
All right.
That's all.
Talk about the fuck.
That just means you rather do Miss Mousy. You find Miss Mousy hot.
Now
that's your punishment.
Got really personal.
Well, I was found
filled.
The guy inside of mice.
You are all weirdos.
And that's why I started the podcast, because we're all weirdos and we love movies.
She just looks like a 5-year-old Miss Piggy. Guys are weirdos.
Actually, that picture kind of makes her look like that video of that little girl who stands on the sink and says, "My whole house is great. I can do anything."
I don't watch the same weird stuff you watch, James.
So, Morgan brings a good point, or Matt did, when...
Jane Russell is. See?
When compared to the practical effects versus...
God damn it, Sonic! Sonic, we thought you were done by now.
I swear to God.
I swear to God, man.
I love you, man. I love you, man. But it's getting really sickening.
I'll be good.
I was going to say that it comes full circle because the Dark Crystal is a proven fact that Particle is better than CGI, which was our first episode 2 years ago. We talked about practical versus CGI. Maybe we brought up the Dark Crystal in that episode. If you want to check out the pilot episode, check it out.
Nope, I'm not in.
Plug, plug, pluggity plug. Plug, plug, pluggity plug.
Plug it in, plug it in.
Mm-hmm. Like Ren 10-10.
That wraps it up for this episode. See? Now, if we had 10 films, this would be twice as long.
Oh, God.
Just imagine we talk about two favorite films. It would
have been
twice as long.
I told you five films is better.
It is, and it's still a long podcast. It's longer than an hour and a half, so it's a 2-hour podcast.
At least it's not that late, you know? It's like 1 in the morning. That's not...
Yeah. No, it's not. It's really good. So... Now you know something about all of us personally. What is your favorite film? Please leave a comment below. Make sure you like and subscribe if you want to see more Cinema Royale.
Leave a comment if you want more of me.
Leave a comment if you'd like to see me return.
Oh, you guys,
and
if
more
you
of
like
her.
Morgan...
And more of me, of course.
And me.
And me.
And me.
Little tease for you guys, if you like Morgan that much, he's gonna come back part-time, but 14 more episodes. 15 total this year. 2015, 15 episodes. Booyah.
Boom.
Any hints about next episode?
Well, if you... Did I elaborate this in the last episode? But I guess I'll say it again. This time's gonna be a little different. We're gonna take a month off, because 2 weeks from now
it's
gonna be awesome. it's going to be the Oscars, so we're going to watch the Oscars 2 weeks from now, and we're going to come back on March 8th, and we're going to react to it.
That was me being very bitter about the Oscars this year. It's fine. I'll talk about it when I talk about it.
Me no like Oscars. I don't trust them.
The Oscars suck.
Agreed.
Especially.
We did this last year, and it was only Matt and I, which was really awkward. It's the first time with two people actually talking about something.
It wasn't that bad.
If you want to check that episode out, too, just to relive what happened for Oscars 2014, check that out as well. And then after Oscars, we'll be back to normal. I'm not giving away that episode. I'll give that away the next time. We're taking a month off. Morgan's taking 2 months off, so he'll come back in 2 months. In April. Yes, April.
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 O'Neill. April
O'Neill. Yes.
He'll be coming back in April O'Neill?
Whoa.
Wait a minute.
Whoa.
Morgan.
There you go, bro.
So much information here.
There you go, bro. You get to score April O'Neill.
Dude, we can tag team with Debbie!
Crystal, you hear me, Crystal? Get in on this fast, you're right!
With that, I'm Mike Mixtape, and remember, long live cinema. We'll see you next time.
See you later, dudes!
Ciao for now.
Later.
Bye.
You're still here? It's over. Go home. Go.